I was a guard at a graveyard, written by Via Creepy. I'm not sure if anyone here actually remembers me. A few months ago, about 10 maybe, I shared a bit about my job as a guard at our local graveyard and how all of that had turned into a dead colleague and a possible stalker. If you don't remember me, hi, I'm Sasha. I'm the kind of guy you meet on the street and walk past because he looks odd enough to stare at for a moment, but not interesting enough to stop for. I'm sorry I haven't given any kind of updates in the past months after I told you guys about the weird package filled with grave earth. But, to be honest, nothing worth telling had happened in the months that passed. The police had investigated the graveyard, interviewed myself about 100 times, and ultimately dropped the case as an unsolved mystery. According to them, they didn't have enough evidence to narrow down any kind of motive, other than a grave robbery gone wrong. A typical wrong place at the wrong time situation. I tried to remind them about the package that was sent to me and the odd phone call, but they weren't able to find any evidence on that either, and it hasn't happened since. I was just starting to believe that this had all been hyped up by my imagination and anxiety into something much bigger than it actually was, and that's why I hadn't thought it important enough to update you guys, and I probably would have stayed of that opinion if it hadn't been for the last week. As some of you might remember, I had spent a good portion of my time right after the package incident living at my friend's flat. I had stayed with Mathis for almost 2 months, and it definitely helped me to get some perspective on the whole situation. I think that was the main reason why I wrote it off to the casual paranoia episode. I had spoken to a therapist, and she had been convinced the thought of being stalked had been triggered by the robbery's trauma. Which, fair enough, that can definitely be a large part of the situation. However, about a week ago, my mother called me. For some people, that may not be an odd situation, or maybe it's even a pleasant one. Not for me, though. We didn't part on the best of terms, and to be frank, I quite literally climbed out of my window at the age of 15 and ran away. So, to say that we're close would be the biggest lie of the century. For her to be calling me already sent me spiraling back into anxiety. She had been vague at first, claiming that we needed to talk, saying there were new things she hadn't considered about our relationship so far. I didn't believe her, and I didn't think anything positive or productive would come out of a meeting with her. But for whatever gut feeling, I ultimately agreed to meet. That was about 2 hours before my father called me to tell me that my mother's funeral would be on Friday, the coming week. I wasn't sure if I should laugh or scream. Honestly, I still don't know for sure. She had sounded odd, yes, but not dead. The moment my father had hung up, I tried calling the number my mother had used. It went straight to the mailbox. I tried again and again, but always with the same results. That night, I attempted something I had never actually considered trying before. I built an altar, and I tried to communicate with her spirit. Yes, I know that sounds stupid, especially because I was almost 100% convinced her spirit would never ever voluntarily choose to hang around my flat. Which is also why I built the altar in my parents' basement, for which I broke in again. Maybe after all of this blows over, I should tell my father to get better security. For the first hour or so, I didn't achieve anything. I was just an idiot sitting on the basement floor with a bunch of candles being the only source of light. Since I had never actually tried anything like this before, I wasn't sure how to properly get my mother to communicate with me, without accidentally inviting all sorts of spirits which were in the area. I remember how my sister had ended up being haunted for over a year when I was very young, just because she hadn't properly set her boundaries during her rituals. The candles on the floor flickered in a bit of wind which was creeping in through the leaky window, and every few minutes I repeated my mother's name and my request for a conversation. She had asked me to come and speak with her. I just hoped that I was doing it right. I'm not sure if 1 or 2 hours passed, but when I started to get very sleepy, I decided to pack my stuff and leave. It felt odd, like I was missing something, but I couldn't quite place my finger on it. Maybe if I had stayed just a little longer, my mother would have spoken to me. But I guess, in the end, she still did. Just not in the way that I had wanted her to. When you call on the spirits, it's important to set boundaries. Clearly state when you start the conversation and make it just as clear when you end the conversation. Make sure the spirits are aware of the moment they're supposed to leave you alone, because otherwise, they might just follow you and stick to your back. And I guess because I expected my attempt to be fruitless, I skipped the last step. When I woke up that night, my lights were off. I always slept with my bedroom door shut and the curtains pulled in front of the window so tightly that not a single stream of light was able to enter my room. I liked the darkness, but this time it felt eerie. Like a thick, uncomfortable, warm pressure. Trying to turn my head to go back to sleep, I noticed that I couldn't. I couldn't move. Not my hands, not my fingers, not my jaw. There were twitches, but it felt like a deep pressure was shoving me back into the mattress, keeping me locked in place. My limbs were so heavy, I was afraid that they'd sink through the bed at any moment. I knew what sleep paralysis was, but it scared me every time anew. The feeling of being stuck, unable to move, forced to stare into the darkness moving around you, your breath barely inflating your lungs. Your jaw unable to part for a scream. I was unable to do anything other than stare up at the ceiling right into the dead but open eyes of my mother. She was lying on the ceiling as if gravity didn't exist. One leg stuck below the other, her arms spread out, and a long, bloody patch on the side of her head. All I could do was stare and panic, dragging in air through my nose, screaming deep in my throat without the sound properly reaching the outside. She didn't move. The darkness surrounding her made her pale skin stand out even more. And then I saw it. Her necklace. Something I had seen so often as a child and entirely forgotten throughout the years. Buried away in my mind as I did with so many of my childhood memories. The necklace, depicting a silver chestnut. I squeezed my eyes shut, taking in a deep breath through my nose in an attempt to calm myself. When I opened my eyes again, she was gone, leaving my ceiling as blank as if she had never even been there. It took me maybe an hour until I was properly able to stand up and walk into my kitchen to get a lot of coffee. My limbs felt strained and my mind was racing, skipping between panicked nonsense and connecting the dots. My mother's funeral is coming up in a few days. I'm not sure what to do. I'm not unaware enough to miss the obvious connection between my mother's chestnut necklace appearing to me and the package months ago mentioning the missing grave of the Chasten family. But I'm not sure if I actually want to dig deeper into this. It appears as if I just narrowly dodged a stalker as well as a bullet. I'm not too eager to get back onto the radar of whoever had left that package, but somehow, I'm fearing my mother's death won't be the last one.